Today we will discuss barrier islands. What are barrier islands? They are thin, long islands that are separated from the mainland by a bay, lagoon, or marsh, and they're separated from each other by tidal inlets. Major parts of a barrier island include the beach, the dunes, and the marsh. And there are several processes that shape barrier islands. There are four of these processes. One of the most important one is called longshore drift. As you see in this figure, as waves come in at an angle, they break and move up the beach. But when the water moves back down, it's going to follow the steepest path. So the water and the sediment that's being moved by the water follows a zigzag pattern. And so sand and water move down the beach. That's called the longshore drift. It's a very important process. One consequence of longshore drift is that if you have a tidal inlet and the longshore drift is, say, one direction, what's going to happen? It's going to add sand to one side of the tidal inlet, but the tidal inlet wants to maintain its opening because the tides have to go in and out, so you get erosion on the other side of the tidal inlet. As a result, tidal inlets can migrate. The third process that operates on a barrier island is the summer-winter change, which is caused by changes in wave energy. In the summer, there's lower wave energy and sand is added to the beach. Sandbars move onshore and the beach becomes wider. In the winter, there's higher wave energy, and the sand is eroded and stored offshore. The fourth process is overwash fans, and this occurs during large storms or hurricanes. What happens is sand is moved from the beach to the back part of the barrier island. It usually shows up as a tongue of sand that goes from the beach to back into the marsh area, the back part of the barrier island. It's a very important process, because it moves barrier islands landward. So what is the key message about barrier islands? If there's one thing you need to remember about them, it's that the sand is moving and that barrier islands are dynamic. The sand is always moving on a barrier island. What are the implications of this movement of sand? Well, think about going to a barrier island. If you have a house on that barrier island, you probably don't want to have the surf zone in the middle of your house. So what do you do? One of the things we do is we build seawalls. And see this picture of the seawall at Galveston. Look out in front of the seawall. Do you want to swim there? It wouldn't be very safe. Seawalls protect cities and property, but they don't produce very good beaches. And another problem with seawalls is they concentrate the wave energy. And little seawalls begat bigger seawalls. In other words, they concentrate it, they undermine the seawall, so you have to build a bigger seawall. Another thing people will commonly do on beaches is to build what are called groins. Now, groins are a wood structure, it may be 3 or 4 feet high, that extends perpendicular out into the surf zone from the beach, usually in front of your house. Why do you do that? Well, it's a dam, if you will, to trap the longshore drift. And it works. It will trap the longshore drift. But the problem is, you will end up having a wider beach in front of your house, but what about your neighbor, which is just down current in terms of longshore drift? They have less beach. They have to build a groin too. So once you start building groins, they extend all the way down the beach. Another thing we commonly do along beaches is called beach replenishment. It's where we add sand to the beach every year sometimes. This is very expensive, and the sand is commonly gone in less than 4 years. So it's not clear it is a long-term solution. I love going to barrier islands, but what do we do about barrier islands? We will debate this later.